Welcome to an introduction on protected shoreland in New Hampshire. My name is Eddie McKenna. I'm the public information manager of the Land Resources Management Program at New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. We'll be covering jurisdictional areas, as well as some of the limits, setbacks, and other requirements associated with any proposed work in these areas. Let's get started. What is the Shoreland Water Quality Protection Act? Well, its main purpose is threefold: to maintain and restore vegetated buffers, to manage or improve stormwater runoff, and to provide critical wildlife habitat. If you'd like to read more specifics into the state statute or rule, that's available under RSA 483B, or the rule is ENVWQ 1400. These are the jurisdictional areas, or the protected areas associated with shoreland in New Hampshire. It starts with lakes, ponds, or impoundments greater than 10 acres. It also includes year-round flowing waters of what we call fourth order streams or greater. It also includes our state's designated rivers. Currently, there are 19 of them. And last, it includes the tidal waters of New Hampshire. What is stream order, you might ask? As used here, the smallest streams, those that are fed by no other streams, are first order. And when two first order streams merge, they form a second order stream. And when two second order streams merge, they form a larger third order stream, and so on. To find a list of designated rivers in New Hampshire, please visit the Rivers Management and Protection section of our website, that be New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. Moving on, let's discuss the reference line. For lakes, ponds, and impoundments of 10 acres or greater, the reference line is fixed. It doesn't change. It's also called the surface elevation. In order to find the reference line for your body of water, or any given body of water, you'll want to consult, you will want to consult the consolidated list of water bodies subject to the Shoreland Water Quality Protection Act. An excerpt from that list is pictured here, but to access the full consolidated list, please visit our website. In designated rivers and year-round flowing waters of fourth order or higher, the reference line is equal to the ordinary high water mark. The illustration on your left, you'll see, is courtesy of the Washington Department of Ecology, and the image to the right is from us at New Hampshire Division of Environmental Services, Department. Basically, the ordinary high water mark, as used here, means an area between the extreme high of a wet winter and the extreme low of a dry summer. There is actually more information available on how to find this line yourself in a manual available from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Now let's go into an overview of specific lines of jurisdiction and the required setbacks, buffers, and limits they include. This illustration is going to cover a number of those lines, starting with the reference line at the water's edge. We'll also talk about the woodland buffer, which is within 150 feet of the reference line. The image you see here, 250 feet in purple, that is the limit of jurisdiction. From reference line to 250 feet constitutes the protected area of the shoreline in question. As I mentioned, 150 feet from the reference line is considered what's called the natural woodland buffer. That area includes what's called the waterfront buffer, which is located within 50 feet of the reference line. This is also the area of setback for the primary building on the property. You'll see that in red there. Top of the bank does vary with the landscape, so it's never a set distance, but it's important to note that that particular area happens to have both shoreland and wetlands jurisdiction. So any proposed work in that area could be subject to one or both. Now let's talk about waterfront buffer restrictions. Removal, as used here, where you see natural ground cover removal prohibited, that means killed. That means cut, sawed, girdled, felled, pushed over, buried, burned, killed, or otherwise destructively altered. So, for example, if cutting something to 3 feet would be likely to kill it, it is advisable not to do that. We're about to transition into an illustration of what this means, but for proposed removal of trees or saplings, you have to create grids and calculate points. Let's take a look at what that looks like. Grids. There's your 50-foot line there, and you want to divide that into 25-foot by 50-foot grid segments, starting from the northernmost or the easternmost property boundary. What if my property is not straight, you might ask? If you follow this process and you make an honest effort, even if your grids aren't perfect, it'll still roughly translate to 1 point per 50 square feet. Again, you see this line, and you see the reference line. And now you see the creation of approximate 25-foot by 50-foot grid segments. Voila. Next up, you'll want to measure and score the trees according to their diameter within those segments. 1 to 3 equals 1 point, 3 to 6 equals 5, 6 to 12 equals 10, and 12 greater equals 15. As you can see, this is that same area divided up into grid segments and scoring the trees associated. If you are going to remove trees, you are required to leave at least 25 points worth of trees and saplings within each grid segment. And you'll need to indicate that on your proposed permit application. Now let's talk about the natural woodland buffer restrictions. As you may recall, that would be 150 feet from the reference line. This is called the unaltered state requirement, which means you must limit vegetation removal between 50 and 150 feet of the reference line. You have to allow native natural vegetation to grow without disturbance, including ground cover. Please note that in theory it is possible, and at times it's even acceptable, for the land to look like it's altered, even though the actual vegetation is not. Some examples might be parking a vehicle beneath some vegetation or staging a picnic table, and that's okay. Moving back to this illustration, we want to make clear that to preserve the unaltered state, it doesn't have to be a single contiguous area. They don't have to all be touching each other. It can be spread out across the property. The dotted red line indicates the top of the bank. Again, that's the dual jurisdictional area between shoreland and wetland, meaning any proposed impact to that area may require a wetland permit application. Again, for woodland buffer reduction, if that reduction has already happened, it's already below 25% of the property, you cannot go below what already exists today. Let's talk about existing open areas close to the waterfront buffer. Those can be considered grandfathered, such as the example you see pictured here. However, existing landscaped areas or gardens are still not considered, quote, natural ground cover for purposes of permit applications. You can maintain an existing lawn. You have to keep your ground cover intact. Further reading, which we recommend, is available in one of our fact sheets. It's called Vegetation Management for Water Quality. That's also available by search on our website. Highly recommended. Now let's discuss impervious surfaces. These too have limits based on New Hampshire statute and rule. What are impervious surfaces, you may ask? These are modified surfaces that cannot effectively absorb or infiltrate water unless they're specifically designed to do so. Common examples include roofs, decks, patios, walkways, or paved gravel crushed stone driveways. These are the impervious surface thresholds. If you want to propose more than 20% of an impervious area, a stormwater management plan must be implemented to infiltrate the results or to infiltrate the resulting increased stormwater that will result from your development. To propose more than 30% impervious area, if any of those grid segments do not meet the maximum required grid score of 25 points, equivalent level of protection must be planted to at least meet the minimum required grid score. And a stormwater management plan must be designed and installed by a licensed professional engineer. Here are some examples of stormwater management. On the left, you'll see an infiltration trench. On the right, you'll see a drainage swale. Now let's discuss pesticides and fertilizers in protected shoreland areas. The use of both is restricted. As a general rule, the use becomes more and more restricted the closer you get to the water. Within 25 feet of the reference line, in all public waters, all fertilizers are prohibited. Within 50 feet of the reference line, all chemicals are prohibited, including herbicides or chemical fertilizers, except when they're applied by a state-licensed professional. Between 50 to 200 feet from the reference line, you can only use slow or controlled-release fertilizers. Let's talk about low-phosphate, slow-release nitrogen. The label on the fertilizer must guarantee at most 2% phosphorus, and the nitrogen components must be at least 50% slow release. This applies to organic pesticides as well. For further reading, we recommend our fact sheet. It's called Pesticide Use Within the Protected Shoreland, and it is also available by search on our website. There's that fact sheet now. Returning to the same illustration as it applies to pesticides, we have our reference line. We have our 250-foot limit of jurisdiction. Now we have everything in between. Here's your 100-foot natural woodland buffer. And if you remember nothing else about pesticides and protected shoreland, within the 50-foot waterfront buffer, illustrated here, you may not have any pesticides below the line. I said red line, it's now being made red. If you have questions, we'd love to hear from you. Specific to wetland or shoreland, you're welcome to email us or call the number on your screen and ask for the inspector of the day. If you have questions about the subsurface or septic systems, you're welcome to call that same number and ask for the reviewer of the day. Or for general wetland questions, you can email us at LRM, that's Land Resources Management, at des.nh.gov. Thanks very much, everyone. We wish you luck, and we hope this has been educational.